Is there anyone here that wouldn't want to enjoy the benefits of getting better sleep and feeling more rested, to be a bit sharper mentally, to have a bit more strength and endurance, to feel calmer with a better outlook because you're refreshed? In the next 15 minutes, I hope to give you a bit of knowledge and a few tips on how to start developing what in this society for many of us is almost considered a lost superpower. It starts with rhythm, an inherent rhythm deep inside of you that goes right down to the cellular level. It's in your genes. Think of this. For the last 3.5 billion years since the origin of life on the planet, the Earth has been bathed in periods of light and dark. Sunrise, sunset. Sunrise, sunset. That drumbeat, think of it, those twice daily activities as a drumbeat that we all dance to. Is it any wonder that wherever biologists have looked, they have found a 24-hour rhythm, a daily rhythm, from cyanobacteria in the oceans to birch trees, fruit flies, all mammals, every organism running on a near 24-hour cycle, the drumbeat of light and dark. It's no wonder, then, that we have evolved with this rhythm inside of us, and it impacts every aspect of our lives. Every cell in your body has clock genes. So, every aspect of your body is governed by this, from your waking moments to sleeping to your mood and emotions and heart rate, blood pressure, all beating in time to this near 24-hour rhythm. A circadian rhythm, as it's called, meaning about a day. So, how does this clock work? Okay, well, it's only in the last few decades that we've started to understand the molecular processes that make up our body's clock, the gears and cogs and springs, so to speak. Briefly, in the nucleus of these cells in our clock that sits about 2 inches behind our eyes, there are two clock genes. And they send out messenger RNA into the protoplasm to manufacture two proteins. Some of these proteins find their way back in to the nucleus and block the expression of the genes that were responsible for creating them. Sounds like government. These neurons are called the suprachiasmatic nucleus. And individually, they keep their own time, but these 20,000 or so neurons, together, they coordinate the clocks in every organ, cell, and process of the body to perform a synchronous dance. The master clock is the conductor of your body's symphony. Hopefully, it's beating in time, playing in time, to the drumbeat of the earth. What sets our clock? Well, there are some things that keep it humming, such as regular meals, physical activity, some social cues, but more than anything else, it is light. From sunrise to sunset, the ambient light provides vital stimulation to the clock, and more than any other kind of light, it is the morning light that you get when you first wake up that's the most important. I'll explain. In the retina of the eye, there are, of course, rods and cones, but there are also, in the very deepest layers in the back, ganglion cells. And a small percentage of these ganglion cells have nothing to do with what you're looking at, but just react to the intensity of the light coming into your eye. Okay? Some of these ganglion cells are responsible for your pupil getting bigger in dark places, smaller and brighter ones, but some of the ganglion cells have a direct pathway to your brain's clock, the suprachiasmatic nucleus, as it's called. And so when morning light hits, it activates those cells and sends the signal to rev up those clock genes, thereby aligning our timekeeping to the local day-night schedule. So what happens when you wake up? Why, you get up and you tear open the curtains, or you get outside for some physical activity, or you go, morning, and wander into a moderately bright room for some coffee. The messages of that morning light are setting your clock and by default influencing all the processes that are dependent upon it throughout the day, from becoming alert, handling stress, timing of hormone release, peak physical performance, top mental acuity, and eventually winding down and falling asleep again. Sleep is another powerful tool in regulating your circadian rhythm. In fact, it is the interplay of light and sleep that, over the eons, has come to develop and evolve your clock to where it is now. Now, of course, we can throw a wrench or two or 20 into the intricate clockworks that are going on, and thereby reducing the effectiveness of the clock or reducing its influence. And then we don't spin with the globe as well as we should. It doesn't line up. It doesn't line up with the spinning of the globe. Swift travel across time zones is probably the most common thing that's thought about. And that's only been around for the last 80 or 90 years of our species' quarter million years on the planet. So the brain hasn't had a chance to really come to deal with that efficiently yet. But staying out late, sleeping in, that's like crossing time zones in your bedroom. I bet you never thought of it like that. And then there's caffeine and alcohol and irregular meals and long naps and changing work schedules and on and on. It's a lengthy list of little wrenches. So I'm going to talk about two enemies, I'll say, of the circadian rhythm or your body's clock, and that tend to be wrenches or disrupt or confuse it. And the first is light. Wait, didn't I just say light is what sets our clock? Yes, natural light is the good witch. Artificial light can be a very wicked witch. The technology that Edison and others developed has opened the night to more fun, more entertainment, more work. But it's also allowed us to move more easily out of alignment with the drumbeat of the solar day. The effects of this misalignment are well documented. In shift workers, for example, there's more cardiovascular disease, mood disorders, diabetes, a host of other maladies. And in a relatively recent paper, it's shown that the springing forward of just 1 hour into daylight saving time results in a brief 24% rise in the incidence of heart attacks on the following Monday. Oh. So then there's the home environment, where the intrusion of screens has brought about a lot of sleep deprivation, and not just from, you know, the games and TV and news that we're watching, but from the light pouring onto our eyes. Okay? And by the way, don't watch the late news, because between the headlines, the weather, the sports, something is going to tick you off. And you don't need that as you're preparing for sleep. TVs are bigger and brighter than ever. Our laptops, our phones, all bathing our eyes in a relatively blue shifted light, which is exactly what stimulates those ganglion cells to signal the suprachiasmatic nucleus that it's still daylight out, and thereby dampening the signals or confusing them that it sends out to the rest of the body. So the surveys have shown that the vast majority of kids and adults spend hours before bed on their phones or laptops or watching TV. One effect of that late night screen time is that it blocks or decreases the amount of melatonin that's produced, And melatonin is a hormone we need to relax and prepare for sleep. So how do you defeat this enemy of a well-functioning clock? You need to be a circadian superhero. You need to have the strength to turn them all off. Put them away for at least an hour, better two, before you go to bed. You know, and you can do something archaic, like read a book. Reading a book, that's one of the steps of good sleep hygiene. And there are lists of sleep hygiene tips on the internet that you can read and keep in mind. Most of them haven't changed in the more than 30 years I've been in the field, but they have been updated because we've invented more ways to intrude on our sleep and mess with our circadian rhythm. Well, I don't like the term sleep hygiene. It's too passive. We need to think of these things as defenders of our circadian rhythm, because just like it takes good morning light to set your clock, you have to protect your sleep to keep it running well. Here's another enemy, so to speak, of the circadian rhythm. It's actually a trigger for anxiety and insomnia, our clock dependence or clock watching. The bedside clock has only been around for the last 150 or so years, give or take. And then we used to rely on church bells or town criers or good old roosters. But with the rise of industrialization and the increased size of cities, well, more pressure has been on us to get to the job on time, and we've allowed the bedside clock to creep in. From the soft, steady tick-tock of the wind-up alarm clock to the silent sweep of the hands across an electric clock face, it has morphed into a hideous digital tyrant with red or green glowing eyes. Numbers. Picture this. Okay, you're asleep. And you wake up and you look over. 2:02. Okay. I get back to sleep, and you just settle in, and you lay there for what seems like a good little while, and you look over, 2:06. Oof. And you turn over, but a little bit of worry is slithering in. I need to get to sleep, or I'm going to feel awful tomorrow. Oh, and I've got that blasted TEDx talk to do. So that little bit of emotional arousal, okay, stimulates the sympathetic nervous system and countermands what your brain's clock is saying you should be doing, leading to being more wide awake. 2:08. That is clock watching anxiety. And we are such a task-oriented society that we make falling asleep a task to be accomplished, which is just the opposite of what we should do, and learn how to let it come naturally. So every time you're looking at the clock, the numbers switch over, you failed. That's why I call it a hideous digital tyrant. 2:10. Studies have shown that people who tend to watch the clock tend to have more insomnia, and in fact, think they sleep less than they actually do when measured in a sleep lab. So, how do you be a circadian superhero? Be a defender of your sleep? Well, you need to defeat this glowing-eyed monster. You need to reach out and grab that clock and turn it around. It's as simple as that. The science shows that people who have anxiety when first going to bed, or if they wake in the middle of the night, sleep better, get back to sleep more easily, have better rest if they're not exposed to the clock. You don't need to know what time it is, okay? Set the alarm so you'll get up. And if you do wake up in the middle of the night, it doesn't matter what time it really is. 1, 2, 3. As far as you're concerned, it's the middle of the night. So don't have the clock where you can see it. You will get better rest and fall back to sleep more easily. So Be a defender of your sleep. Be a circadian superhero and dance to the rhythm of the planet. Thank you.